number of reasons why we would do this. One, of course, is to replace the culture camp, because the knowledge keepers were wanted to be very careful with that one. So we had to postpone that one, and we had to come up with something else to involve the students in learning about our traditions. So that's one aspect of it. The other one, of course, is the COVID-19 situation, where on one level people are generally, you know, scared of that sickness. It's going around, and we wanted to do something that would alleviate a little bit of that fear. Like, if people actually do something in terms of maybe mitigating the fear of that COVID-19, if people do something to prepare for it, it lessens their fear. So generally, there wasn't a lot of fear, but it helps with to make people at ease that there is food security. And that's the third item, is to go after food security, to make sure that our people here from the community would have enough food in the event anything that might happen. We know from last winter, or earlier on in the spring, where shelves were becoming empty in different parts of in different areas of the globe, I guess. I don't know if it happened in Canada, but shelves were getting depleted, stocks were getting depleted, and people talk about, in the event, what if everything has to be shut down, which would include the grocery stores, and where would our people get food? So that was a big item as well. That's when we talk about food security, to make sure we have enough food to last at least 2 weeks to a month for all the families in the community, for those who should need them. And of course, we always do this anyway, but on a smaller scale, to get traditional foods for our elders, including berries, including smoked meat, including packaged meat, hamburgers, potatoes, different items that we supply to them. Usually around Christmas time, as sort of like a Christmas present. But these are traditional foods that we're promoting. Traditional foods are promoting land-based learning and land and resources use.
Remember, I was showing you animals how to say them in Cree? Say apischi?
Apischi.
Moosus. Can you say that, Jessa? Apischi moosus. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
this is the hide tanning section. We're gonna attempt to put the hide on the frame, and once we get that on there, we're gonna scrape the flesh off first, and then let that dry for a few, you know. Yeah. It takes a while though.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
what kind of hide is it?
It's a moose.
Moose hide.
Moose hide, yeah.
And then what would you use, what would you use some of the moose hide for then after?
It would depend on what the person would want it for. A lot of people use, moccasins, gloves, you could even, but because it's moose, it's a little bit thicker. Some people would use it for drums, whether it's hand drums or the big drums.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Awesome.
But it's a 14-day process.
Oh, wow. And what's your name? Just why?
Cynthia.
Cynthia, okay. Yeah.
I've seen that change and that interest is there. Even I do K to grade 12, but kindergartens are still a little too small, but that's where you start engaging the kids about the land, about the earth, like everything is related in it, respecting the trees, respecting the animals, respecting the plants. And so I do that with all grades, and yes, I've definitely seen a change. Even if I'm walking down my classroom, like they know the type of work that I do. If I'm walking down the classroom, they'll say, "Hey, let's go kill a beaver," or they'll say, or even the boys, they've been bugging me, "Let's go hunting." You know, these some of the kids that I mentor, even out of the school setting, like on weekends or on my own time, that interest is there. Like, let's go fishing, let's go canoeing, or let's go hunting. They've been bugging me to go hunting, because a lot of these kids here come from parents that are single parents or are raised by elderly grandparents that no longer take them out on the land because they're just too elderly. So they miss out on that opportunity, and that's where the school or I step in. And I also have some people that help me out in the school, take the kids out. But there's definitely, yes, I see a big change. The interest is there. Even like I incorporate, I'm a Cree speaker, so I incorporate a lot of language into what I do. Yeah, it does. It has teeth. See that?
Ew!
Ew! Look at his teeth.
That's its tongue.
Look at Lena. Look at his teeth.
Look at that. You know how people know how old a moose is? They take that tooth, the back one right here, just like your back one, and they sand it down. They cut it into a thin piece. They look at it in a microscope, and there's circles on there. It determines how old that moose. There should be some in the bucket there. They're cutting up the ad. 3 to 4 hours for a long time. And it's eaten as like an appetizer. Like you can't eat the whole thing. And they also or soup. And they also use it for feast. When they have a feast, they have to have a moose nose.
Here?
Yeah. And this one here is a bull moose compared to this one. This one was a young moose. Most likely female, and this one is a bull moose. And yeah, you could touch it. And I'm trying to get this. I was showing the kids how you age, how you know how old the moose is. I don't know, but they take a tooth out and they file it down. So until it's like super thin, when you put it under a microscope,
And then you there's circles on there. You count those rings for every ring. 20 years old.
Yeah, like a tree.
Look at it, looks like it's sticking its tongue out.
And you know why you cut the moose nose off? Because people eat it. There's one in the fire there, I'll show you.
Best part of the moose is the nose.
So, and then you do the same thing to the other side. Just keep cutting it. And you're done that. So when this one, then I put it on here. See that? No, it's not a duck. It's that moose nose. See? You just keep scraping it off, scraping off all that hair. It takes a long time.
Yeah,
you're changing that air.
Oh, yeah.
Big
power
cell. This is a moose nose.
Go ahead.
See that? You just missed our, we just did a moose nose just now. We cut it off.
Yeah.
I'll show you right here.
Oh, it's feet burned.
Right here, Haley, look. We just cut this. We cut it all around here to the end. And then this is how it comes out. This is just cartilage.
You go there if you want.
And then I take this.
Okay, sure.
And I put it over the fire and it takes
I'm bumping
hours
people.
And then I've only seen them ever done, and that was for feast.
Yeah.
I've never seen them.
Lots of people will just cut this one off, but the elder just told me just leave it on there.
Cut what off?
Like this cartilage here?
Yeah.
So at the end of the day, when this is all shinned down to the bottom, really all that's left is the cartilage. So, and you eat it as an appetizer, like you can't eat it as a whole meal. You eat it as an appetizer. And these are like just parts of the...
of the nostril?
The parts of the moose nose that probably got cut off. And like I said, they don't waste anything. So you just kind of scrape off, see the charred part? You just keep scraping it off. And you put it back in the fire. I need a glove.
You know how
they know how old the moose is? You take one of their teeth, and you file them down till they're really, really paper thin. Then you look at them under a microscope and you'll see circles on there. For every circle, they're 1 year old.
When I was nine years old.
Oh, when you were
nine. Yeah.
I didn't even pick any berries this year, I just bought my berries.
Oh, did you?
I did a lot of planning at home.
So How long when you can berries, how long do they last then? Like in the can?
6 months.
6 months?
6 months to a year. Yeah.
Oh really?
Yeah.
And if you freeze them, they last a bit longer, but
yeah.
Still 6 months if you just can.
Yeah. I wonder if that's my phone.
He's cooking at
me. I'm cooking berries.
It's definitely very important because it shows that it not only it's like a communal thing. It brings out our knowledge keepers. It brings out our elders who are like, you know, very very carry a lot of knowledge. It brings out the whole people, and just the feel of having everybody working together to make it happen. And at the end of the day, it's like you said, it's not only for the kids, it's for everybody in the community. It's hopefully there's more of this every year. You know, it shouldn't even be just a fall thing, because us indigenous people were once regulated by the seasons. It should be a seasonal camp, really, because there's different teachings with different seasons, different animals, different way of doing things. So keeping those traditions alive is a must, and it should keep going, and I'm pretty sure it will. Like Sturgeon Lake has it's very cultural, but it's just this past few years that the kids are getting involved more and more and more, and the elders are very happy. The people of the community are happy about that, and it's very important.
Why do you turn them over?
You see that there's no air bubbling?
Okay.
Yeah.
Did it help?
Then you put them away in the morning.
24 hours. I just don't give them my dad for 24 hours.
For 24 hours?
Yeah. And we'll be ready by tomorrow. Oh,
I need another hand here.
Come and taste this thing. There's not sugar in it. Not a sweet stuff.
Where's your teaspoon?
Not a berry, just a juice.
Yeah, I didn't say that. You must stingy with berries.
Yeah, I know, eh? She counted the berries.
Not really.
Need some more sugar?
Yeah.
Are you sure? I thought that was sweet enough.
It's sour.
Not for me.
Oh yeah, okay, now I taste it.
It's sweet.
It's sweet.
I think. You better tell me, because...
Yeah.
They're good?
Yeah, they're good.
They're good to go to start planning for Sonia. Are you done?
Oh no, I'm just picking out this lard. I gotta cut this lard and there's no knives on the side, eh? I'll ask somebody to cut this one.
And if you're gonna throw your fish in again, that's why they have a slime there, because it protects them, but they actually breathe from their, right here.
Do they have multiple breathing?
Okay, so what do I do first? If you watched me earlier, what do I do first?
Take the head off.
Yeah, you take the head off.
Rip it off. Oh, don't knock my head, knock my head, you think.
I need a different, is there, different. Give me another, one of those, orange one. Where's Willie's son? I think he was,
fish.
I think he was supposed to get,
lots of fish.
I think he was supposed to go get fillet knives. I really like to pull it because he salvaged the meat that way.
Is that a white fish?
No, this is a sucker. I'm trying to take it.
Okay, I didn't see it.
Trying to take the head right here. They eat them, eh?
They eat the heads off the moment?
They eat the whole thing? They eat the whole thing. Some people just
love eating those things.
Yeah. Some people just throw them away, but it's still flopping.
It's last flops then.
Yeah.
Yeah, my Mr. Danny used to love these things.
That was so cool. That was
you know what? I will make these gloves.
Yeah, because this one's the most bloodiest one.
These are not fillet knives, so they're a little harder.
There's a couple of them inside.
Okay, bring it, please. Yeah. Willie's supposed to get somebody to pick some up.
What do you need exactly?
Where's that yellow bucket? I need some water.
Come on, that's what I'm taking.
No, thank you. I don't have patience for that. There. Yeah, that's exactly it. That's a over here, boys, look, on the other side. Watch your back, Raymond.
What happened?
Right there. Thank you. Check out Cecil yet?
No.
On the other side?
Oh, this one's tough.
That one's a pickerel. That one's a walleye.
Oh, Abraham!
What?
Oh, this one's still
moving.
One is still alive.
It's still going. Their nervous system is still going.
Nothing? Okay, I think Willie was gonna send his son to go get some at his house. Okay, did you tell him?
So how long have you been doing this, Tanya? Most of your life?
Yeah, I grew up with my grandparents. Like, I was raised by my grandparents who lived out in a trap line seasonally. They were hunters, fishers, gatherers. Like, my grandfather's source of income was from trapping.
Right.
Before trapping collapsed.
Right, right.
But that's where I learned it from.
Nice.
And then I passed down the skills to my daughters. Like, my daughter, as we speak, is out hunting. She left 3:30 this morning. So she had her first bull moose 2 years ago, and then she had her second bull moose last year. Mm-hmm. For her 21st birthday, she got a rifle. And so I just passed down my skills, got my skills from my grandparents.
And I know we kind of talked about this yesterday, but
How important do you think it is for young people? And we all know how important it is, but how important do you think it is for young people to kind of get this experience and know how to do this?
I think it's very important because a lot of it is lost already, and a lot of our children don't get the opportunity to be out on the land. But the elders and others, but mostly elders, they take the sucker heads, they boil them, and then they eat the meat from here and the cheeks.
Oh, okay.
And then if you people want to take the time, they take the suckers, and then you smoke them, and then you cook them. So this here is a sucker.
Okay.
This here is a walleye. This one has a nickname, pickerel, but really it's a walleye. That's the real name for it.
Okay.
And then this one is the northern pike.
This
one has a nickname too as a jackfish, but really it's a northern pike. But this is like this is what every fisherman wants to catch, right? This is like the gold. And you take the pickerel cheeks, you take the fillets, and people take this fin too.
Okay.
And these pickerel cheeks here that I extracted from here, these are actually sold in restaurants as an appetizer. This bone here, strip of bones, and the skin. As appetizers.
Yeah.
I'll show you after we have
them.
Hi, Auntie. You come watch your niece? Well, I showed you. I don't know so
much. You learn from the best.
Look, catch a tie.
You learn from the best, my girl.
Look, catch this one too.
I know. It's
so slimy.
Well, I.
Alive still?
No. They might have been caught this morning, so they're still kind of breathing around.
Watch out, they'll slap you.
like this. I want to see it happen.
They'll pull ninja moves on you, Abraham.
Okay, this fish is like me now. It just waits until it's
you never ate one? Oh my God, you will love them once they're smoked and then fast fried.
Yeah. That one was pregnant too.
Yeah. See the egg? Wait, do they use every piece of the fish? Even the tail?
A bunch of fish.
Kind of.
Minnows.
they use the...
So you cut along the rib right here, see that? All the bones are on there, even though...
I'm gonna stand behind you here.
I'll take both of them, won't I?
Yeah. Yeah, I'll just take both of them.
This will tell them.
So the one on the right is the beef, right? No, it's just both pork.
They're both pork.
The first one's the beef?
You have to turn this one
off. Oh, we have to move this one around.
I'm behind you, by the way.
It's all bad, Dalieta?
No.
What else do we have? Yeah, see? Where's that label? That steel one. I think they came and bought
that. That's what they came and bought.
Yeah. They took all our labels, so. I won't have one label for my berries yet. Do you have any more jars in there now? Mm-hmm. Remember that big steel thing we had? That's what I worked better, right?
We didn't have a strainer this morning too much.
Yeah, this morning
we were using it. So what we did, we put a dish towel over that.
Over the bowl.
And then therefore it didn't do that.
This is working.
Yeah.
I think this is pig fat, and we cut it up into squares. We throw it in the oven, we melt off all the grease. This is Indian popcorn.
Right.
And then she puts her grease in there, and she mixes it with this. And then this is lard. Yeah, and then they keep it by keeping it in the fridge. Freezer. Yeah, and this is like a delicacy. We eat this with banana.
Yeah, I remember the first time I had it in my cocoa, and I'm like, what is this?
Yeah, Indian popcorn.
I found it.
Paper or what?
Yeah.
If we do what? We should maybe cut that in half.
If somebody wants to go in and cut.
Huh? Cut that in half.
No. There's. I love it.
Here's to you.
It's coming along.
Hello, Spencer.
Put it here, eh?
Yes. Tenderloins and dinnerloins.
It's part of that meat.
And the ribs, you just cut them like a suitcase.
Floyd, what's the meat for you?
That's the peanuts.
Yeah.
Put
it in there, your mouth.
Yeah. Chewy. Just had two forks, two of them.
Who killed this? You,
yeah? Okay.
I don't shoot meal deer, they don't taste it. You know, they say mule deer and Cree, something about big ears.
Yeah, they have big ears, eh?
Mule deer?
Yeah, big floppy ears. And they're still nosy.
Deer, but there's a way to say mule deer.
That's Gilbert.
What do you say mule deer in Cree?
Is it Tupipugo?
Apsimos is a deer, but there's a way to say mule deer. Something about big ears.
Avagito
leo. Apsimos.
Apsimos.
Sounds about right.
Yeah, big ears, deer.
Big ears, deer.
Stop.
Mom.
Look, yeah, that's a good chunk of meat going in the inner ones, eh?
Good. How do you say, what was it again?
Mule deer.
Mule deer in Cree. Ask Charlie Brown.
Charlie Brown.
How do you say mule deer in Cree?
Gilbert was close. Eh? You were close, Gil.
How do you say it?
Oh my boy, I'm gonna rip your pants. You can't go
close
to there once they put that oil in there.
It's already, no.
It's, again, that might happen at different levels. Certainly there is that we really have to continue. The elders always talk about this, that we have to continue to try and pass down our traditions. This year in particular, I think with, you know, a global pandemic, people realizing that they have different thoughts about it in terms of their own survival. You know, what, again, as I just talked about the grocery stores, if they happen to close, where would we get our food supply, and are our young people equipped to understand or to start to even know how to obtain food resources from the land, not only the meat, and but how to, say, for example, set snares or set nets, or even to shoot, how to hunt, all those things. There's so many items in there that they can learn about. Now, I think more and more in this past year, particularly, I've seen that there are a lot of young people that are being involved with those activities. There's a lot of land-based learning happening, and more so. And it's directed in the right places in terms of survival skills, and that's what we're talking about, our survival skills. So it's hard to sometimes gauge how much growth would happen in education. In the education field, in terms of learning about survival skills, it's very hard to gauge. We just have to continue, but I think the really important thing that we want young people to see is how a community comes together, how the Kukums and Mushums do things, to see community people come together. It's very important for the young people to see that that this can be normal in a community without drugs or alcohol, without any kind of all those things we hear about how poor our people are. You know, we try to show that our people are rich, that our people are resourceful. We have a lot of skills. We have a lot of things that we can teach about. These things, we have to keep pushing for these things so that the young people, we know in youth behavior, youth development, that they may hear or see things when they're young, and it happens to most people when they see things when they're young. Those kind of memories get stored, and they later on in life they start to click, they start to remember those things that they saw, and it becomes a seed that for them that that they can continue those practices.
That one you have to hold. Well, so it's sealing still, so maybe you don't have to hold it. So you feel it press down. There you go. Seems like as long as you have this top part over here.
It's all about the elders, it's all about the young people, it's all about the whole community coming together.